I'm Melissa Idris, and you're watching The Future is Female, the show where we find the extraordinary in every woman. Now, today on the show, I have with me Fern Chua, who is a contemporary batik designer. Fern, welcome to the show. It's lovely to have you here.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm very excited.
So we're going to talk about all things batik today.
Yes.
And, you know, I want to begin with that, you know, your passion for batik. Why batik specifically? Because batik is so synonymous with Southeast Asian culture. But for Malaysia specifically, batik has its own kind of importance, right? So let's begin there. Let's talk a little bit about the importance of batik to the Malaysian culture.
Yeah, well, for me, you know, I think when it comes to batik, it speaks a lot about our heritage as well. And it's also, you know, it tells a lot about our culture. It tells a lot about history of the past, of where people come from and how it has evolved. And, you know, there's just so many different parts through the evolution.
Of batik,
and,
right?
Yes, yeah. Yes. And it's very fascinating. Like, I never thought about that. Like, you know, and then when I started to learn about it, you know, how batik actually came from Indonesia, from Malaysia side.
Because that's a bit contentious, isn't
it?
Oh,
yeah, yeah, definitely.
Where it comes from,
yes,
is a bit,
yes, exactly. But, you know, we can't deny that. Like, you know, there is the history, or, like, you know, there is a part that actually mentioned about that. And, you know, how we brought it across into to the Malaya Straits and how it has changed, you know, from there. You know, because in the past, it used to be worn for, you know, really formal events, for, you know, like, literally, you know, where people are born with batik and die with batik, kind of.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah. So there's so many meanings and symbols, and different patterns tell different stories. And, you know, from the Indonesian side of things, it's completely very traditional.
So what's the difference between Malaysian batik and Indonesian batik?
Well, I think it all comes down to the designs.
Okay, so the designs,
the technique is exactly the same.
Okay.
And for me, I'm a purist.
Oh, okay, all
and
right.
And for me, I felt that what makes batik is actually the technique. It's
okay.
Not the patterns. And patterns are just a form of telling stories, telling the trend at the time where.
Oh, so it can change.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the motifs and the patterns can change according
Definitely.
To time. Okay.
Yeah, but I felt that at one point Malaysian batik went into this, like, I don't know, it just went into a stop motion where, you know, it just got stuck there.
Okay, so
for
stagnant,
the longest,
it
went into stagnant.
Okay.
Where, you know, when it first brought over here, or, you know, the sarong, the very traditional sarong,
okay,
and, you know, people use it for kabayas and baju kurungs and different outfits for the formal traditional wears, and how it was, and then it becomes this a burst of colors, a burst of,
okay,
Florals, a burst of, like, you know, abstract designs. But then it was just, like, you know, it was constantly exactly the same thing.
Right.
Like, I felt so that
it
way.
So it was kind of just repeating the same motifs,
yes,
and,
yes,
patterns,
yes,
without really evolving the design.
Yeah. Okay. So there was so many evolution period, and I just felt at one point it was stagnant, and that's when actually I took notice of that.
Okay.
And then the younger generation's like, no, no, I'm not going to wear batik anymore. I can't see to wear something like this, because it seems to be like it's only for the older generation,
right,
who's going to wear it for formal functions.
It feels very traditional,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Yeah,
and there's,
yeah,
always that connotation or that association. But I just want to come back very quickly. You said you're a purist about the technique.
Yes.
But when it comes to batik technique, Indonesian batik and Malaysian batik, made the same way.
It's pretty much the same. I won't go into too details,
well,
in terms of the techniques.
Can you tell us a little bit, mm-hmm, about the process? I mean, to a layperson like myself,
mm-hmm,
I see it as, you know, you put the wax on and then you,
yes,
paint and then,
yes,
you remove the wax.
Exactly. So it's true, like, different process. Like, you know, it's just much more of, like, you know, you draw a pattern but using wax. The wax, the idea is to actually create resistance on the dye, on the fabric. And then from there you preserve the color, and then, you know, eventually you boil off the wax.
Okay.
And then voila, you have a piece of beautiful
batik
with patterns on,
right,
it. Yeah. So you see, the thing is, you know, when you mentioned about that, like, you know, of course Indonesia has their way, but when I say that, you know, being a purist, is because I realized that a lot of people didn't understand,
oh,
what makes batik anymore. But when they see this sarong or this kabaya sarong or this traditional batik motifs, they think that's batik. I mean, there's two sides to, you know.
So batik is more than just a print or pattern.
Yes.
It's also the technique.
It's the technique
that goes into it that makes batik very special.
Yes. Okay. So, well, basically, if you think about it, batik. So it is a synonym, like, you know, how they actually manitik.
Oh,
so they
apply where it comes from.
Yeah. So that's actually the term.
All right.
And so basically they apply the wax on the fabric and draw the patterns on it. So people seem to miss, you know, there's like a misconception of, like, especially when it comes to the younger generation, when they see a certain print or certain, you know,
they think that is batik without understanding how it's made.
Yes.
Okay.
So, you know, that is the part where I felt that there are so many miscommunication, like it's just got stuck somewhere. And the idea for me always is to educate people and to actually let people understand how we do our own batik, how do we create our pieces and things like that. So a lot of people were wondering, like, oh, you know, what makes you doing batik, and you know, how can you explain that your patterns are batik, you know? So there are a lot of all these things that I have to clarify.
Okay, because you've opted for a contemporary design of batik. So looking at your pieces, you don't automatically associate it with the patterns that we've come to be very familiar with, as you mentioned, with the kebaya sarongs or the, you know, the government batik shirts. You know, we don't normally associate it with that. But I would like to come back and continue this conversation, Fern, and talk a little bit about how you started as a fashion designer and the role that batik plays in your design. We're going to continue this conversation right here on The Future is Female. Stay with us. Welcome back to The Future is Female. I'm Melissa Idris. I've got Fern Chua here with me. She's a contemporary batik designer. We are talking about how batik has had a bit of a renaissance lately in terms of moving away from the association of being traditional and kind of old, stuffy fashion to now young and contemporary and fresh and a different kind of design, but remaining true to the technique of batik.
Yes.
Looking at the landscape of batik, I mean, you know, of course batik has become very commercialized, and in that sense you've got printed batik no longer using perhaps wax. Could you give us a sense, Fern, of the demand and supply of the batik industry in Malaysia?
Well, for me, I felt that, you know, there's always demand, like, you know, in all different sectors.
Right.
But definitely there is a lacking of understanding or the want and needs of, like, you know, being attracted to buy batik before I actually came around.
I would say.
Because everyone's been wanting to suit their daily lifestyle, to understand the idea of, you know, how, you know, these days a lot of people can't seem to relate. Like, you know, you wear a lot of jeans, you wear a lot of basics, you know, t-shirts. And
sure, it's very Western.
Yeah,
it's a very Western
exactly.
style of clothing.
Modern. So there's all these things that you've got to consider, like how you're able to combine or, like, you know, basically match it with all these basics that you have, right?
Okay.
Because also at the same time, it's just about, it used to be, like in the past, like batik is part of daily wear. You know.
Okay, so
and
there was a time when batik was a staple in everyone's closet. But now it's, you know, it's really hard to kind of imagine pairing that with your jeans and sneakers, just going out to hang out with your friends. So I think one of the things that I've been seeing recently is that a lot of younger fashion designers have really embraced this, you know, heritage textile and made it fresh and contemporary for a younger audience. So talk to me about when you decided you wanted to do that.
Well, there goes my life story. But so 10 years ago I had a car accident, two tendons and median nerve cut later, had to do rehabilitation for my hand movement. And so that's actually when I really thought about what I wanted to do. So I decided to actually learn how to sew. And from sewing, I stumbled across batik and I fell in love with it. I bought some fabric just at Central Market. And I was like thinking to myself, like, well, why is nobody trying to do something different? And we have such beautiful fabrics and nobody's trying to do some sundresses, something that they can use daily.
Right.
So there goes my idea, and I started to learn more and more. I snoop around the back of, you know, different artisans. I went around to learn. It was very interesting journey, and that was actually really taught me a lot, like, you know, how I actually can combine. And I mean, with my own aesthetics and, you know, in terms of like aesthetics, batik aesthetics into my fashion way of looking at things. So there's a lot of different side of things. I have to kind of put it into a jigsaw puzzle and kind of, you know.
Okay, you're piecing,
yeah,
things,
piecing
together.
Things together. Okay. So there's all these elements that I have to figure it out. And, you know, eventually I've always loved art. Like, you know, I always been drawn to, since young, like, I always loved doing paintings,
creating,
and all, creating different
expressing
things.
Expressing yourself,
yes.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, it was just lost somewhere in the middle after graduating and things like that. So I never embraced it until then. This accident took me by surprise, and it was almost like a blessing in disguise for me to ended up being in this field.
Okay. And so it kind of gave you a sense of purpose and a bit of clarity that this is what you wanted to
do.
At what point, Fern, did this become more than just a hobby, and you said, okay, this is going to be a career for me, and a business, a profit-making business?
So, you know, I kind of got myself more into it, and I stumbled across this brand called Ruskahara. They're textile designers, batik textiles. And, you know, we decided to do a collaboration, and during that time, we were very eager to learn about each other's, you know, way of able to bring a different side of batik into our current.
They were a local fashion house,
batik
house.
Yes.
And you decided to collaborate.
My designs. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
So I create all the silhouettes using their fabrics, and I thought to myself, like, whoa, this is impressive. Like, this is really exciting. And the best part was that I was actually starting to sell. I consigned with different boutiques. I was actually selling in Singapore, and because of the price and, you know, wanting to explore a little bit that, you know, how people from not from the same market could actually appreciate that. And there were a lot of expats in Singapore.
Not from the Malaysian market, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, so so an international audience has an appreciation for
batik.
Okay.
Yes. And that really caught my attention. Like, you know, for me, it was like almost like a mission now to actually try to change Malaysians' thinking. Like, hey, look, even the international platform can appreciate something what we have, and it belongs to us, our part of our heritage. And why are we not looking, you know, to batik? Like, you know, why are we not appreciating something that is so great to us?
The challenge for me, from an outside perspective, I would say, is building scale with something like batik design, right? Because you said, as yourself, you're a purist with the technique.
Yes.
How do you build scale, Fern, while maintaining that the quality, maintaining that kind of handcrafted feel that you want to keep?
Well, it's a long process.
Okay.
I'm not gonna lie. Initially,
was it difficult to build scale?
Yeah. So when I started off after the collaboration that I did with Ruskahara, and, you know, I always loved their design, but the thing is that I have to kind of stay true to my own aesthetics. I have some ideas of what I wanted to do. And so for me, it's about a collection telling my inspiration, my stories. And each collection actually brings out different elements of, you know, different patterns and different techniques as well at the same time. But back to your question, at the same time, you know, when we were talking about that, is that I actually, you know, I joined a competition, and, you know.
Ah, this was the My Creative Ventures, wasn't
yes,
it? You won that
yes,
competition
yes.
2013, if
yeah,
I'm not mistaken.
That was so long ago now. But it was a steep climb. Like, you know, my investors were very worried for me at one point.
Right.
They were like, hey, you're not doing much. What's going on?
Okay.
It's been a year.
Because they want to see progress.
Yeah, but because, you know, finding the artisans was one of the biggest challenge. Finding the right
supplier. To create
supplier.
The batik pieces?
Okay. Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. And so that took me such a long time to set up my team. That took 3 years, literally, to stabilize the team, to actually understand the fundamentals of of doing this business. So, you know, it was taking a long time, but you know, it was through perseverance and, you know, being adamant about the fact that, oh, you know, I wanted to do something different for batik, that really carried me forward, you know. And
because, you know, fashion design is not just about the creative elements, it's also a business. You're thinking about finance and human resources and all the things that build a business.
Exactly.
When you are looking at putting this together, Fern, there must be some kind of underlying principle for this. So when you represent your brand, what do you want Fern to stand for?
Well, we want to stand for being a modern design house that uses batik technique to create our pieces. And, you know, elegant, modern, chic, easy pieces that is versatile, that every woman can use. And actually, we're actually planning to expand into menswear and also more of, like, you know, little accessories here and there. So it's actually driven by batik, but at the same time, it's very interesting how it started off there, and then you get drawn to more and more different elements as well. Like, now I'm starting to actually learn about weavings. I started to learn about, you know, even like songkets, and, you know, I'm starting to learn a little bit about different elements that makes us, you know, all of our artisanal crafts. Like, what we have amazing stuff.
We do.
Why are we still so fixated about looking outside and not looking inside? You know what I'm talking about.
Well, let's come back and continue our conversation, especially about support for local designers. Stay with us right here on The Future is Female. Thank you for staying with us on The Future is Female. I'm Melissa Idris with Fern Chua, a contemporary batik designer. We were talking a little bit about what you want Fern to represent. I also read that you are into, I guess, making sure that the brand stands for an environmental friendly approach, yes?
Yeah, well, environmental friendly approach is the fact that we're all using natural materials.
Okay.
So, over time, it's not going to harm the planet.
Okay.
But we are still working towards trying to also see what we can do to actually save water.
Because a lot of water is used in the dyeing process, right?
Yes, okay. Definitely. So there are a lot of all this, but we're more focusing being sustainable, being ethical, being also, you know, providing fair wages for the local artisans here. So there are so many different elements that we're trying to carry out. So I wouldn't start to actually look into one specific area. But
just want it to be an ethical brand?
Yeah, being a sustainable brand is, I think, it's a key to the future. Mm-hmm. If you ask me, it's all about that. You know, when you talk about like fast fashion, it's just crazy like how things have changed these days. Like, you know, yeah, we probably shop in Zara all the time, we shop in H&M, but the truth is the fact that people have less and less appreciation for this sort of brand.
That's true though, but I mean, fast fashion is cheap and it's accessible. How do you view those two points when you're thinking about your brand, especially in terms of price point and accessibility?
Yeah, well, I like to price a very different side of looking at things, because first of all, you know, we talk about the design process itself. It takes double amount of work compared to a lot of other designers.
Of course.
Literally, we have to design all of our patterns ourselves, and based on my own inspiration and developing and trying to figure out every of the single piece of the pattern, how it matches with different silhouettes. I think there's so many different elements, and it literally takes a team to actually goes on into doing coming out with a collection. But at the same time, when we were talking about this, is that, you know, we are more focused in terms of looking at how we are able to be part of everyone's essential wardrobe, like everyday's wardrobe.
So you still want it to be accessible, but there is a certain value that comes with creating these designs, and it has to be priced accordingly.
Yes. So, like, for example, I would think, like, there's one piece of my design, which is my multi-way scarf. So it is a little bit more pricier, But the thing is, the beauty is that you have one of a kind piece
okay.
to begin with. And then the second part is that you can wear it 10 different ways. And you feel that you are able to reuse again. You know, it's so versatile. You can use it for different functions. I always think about how I can try to give that sort of bang for the buck.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, so you always think about that. Like, I would think about that. Like, you know, they are comfortable pieces because they're all natural materials. You know, we're using the top quality notch of materials. So it's an investment piece, basically. You can be using it again and again, and not something from Zara where you use it 2 times, 3 times, and it's, you know, gone out of shape.
So you're hoping to be the opposite of fast fashion, right? Some pieces that last. How are you marketing it to a younger audience, especially in light of, you know, what we talked about, batik having this connotation of being very traditional, very formal? How do you, you know, convince millennials to wear batik? So batik is cool again, guys.
I guess it's a lot of work, I'm not going to lie. But the beauty about it is that, you know, how I actually combine my own aesthetics, being modern, being contemporary, being abstract, being minimal. And so my designs are a little bit more friendlier to the millennials, I would say. The colors are, I think, one of the most key essentials in terms of when I come up with a blouse, for example. I would think about, would this color actually matches the bottoms? Like, what are the bottoms of colors? We can't go wrong. White, beige, black, blue.
So trying to keep it as simple as possible so it matches what you already have in your wardrobe.
Yeah, okay. So you have being versatile, right? Mm. You are able to actually reuse it again for different, you know, it's all about that. And also at the same time, how do you actually, what flatters them? I think for me, it's not just about batik. To be honest, I feel that there are so many more amazing artisans out there who's doing more like really beautiful designs too at the same time, but the thing is, the key to it is actually a combination of things. Like I said, it's an element, jigsaw puzzle,
right,
that I was referring to, that you have to literally put it together, that you have to see that, oh, you know, it's not just a piece of fabric, it's not just batik, but it has to make you look good, it has to make you feel good of wearing it. So there's all these elements that you are able to actually put it into picture for
so,
a client.
I mean, if a piece of, you know, a clothing or attire makes you feel good, looks good, it doesn't matter if it's batik or, you know, people will not kind of gravitate to it one way or another if it is a certain type of design. I do want to ask you, Fern, about support for local designers. Have you seen support for local designers increase in recent years?
I mean, definitely.
Is there kind of an awareness to support our local designs?
Yes, I felt that. I think through social media, it's just so great. Like
you're using social media too,
of course. But I mean, everyone's using that, right? And Instagram and Facebook and what so. But then again, you know, we don't really have to do too much of talking. The trend itself, it's speaking for itself. Like, you know, people in the international level are starting to appreciate indie brands more than anything else, because at the end of it, people are not just looking at the fact that, you know, oh, wow, you know, yes, it's great to have a piece that perhaps, you know, that one of the biggest brand out there. And the thing is that it doesn't make them any different. You know, the idea about, I think local designers are great because they try to adapt into our culture at the same time as well. So me being a Chinese as well, I always think about, okay, what can I do to actually cater for different market, different race, and, you know, it's all about that. It's really about that. For me, it's really about trying to respect different cultures, different racial backgrounds, and also at the same time, what makes women different, you know. So there's so many different elements that I'm always constantly thinking about and playing in my head, and so, yeah.
Well, you know, I spoke to an academic about preserving intangible heritage, right? So skills like this, like the weaving of kain pua, for instance, or, you know, the drawing of batik. These are heritage textiles that are important to be preserved in our culture, in our heritage. What are you doing to make sure that this heritage is not lost for future generations?
Well, this is what I'm doing, basically.
Right.
It's exactly what I'm trying to do. It's not to get it to a certain point that, you know, it's forgotten.
Right.
It at some point, I would say that, you know, recently, I mean, recent years, batik is making a comeback, and it's great. You know, you see a lot more appreciation. Like I mentioned as well, like, you know, especially on the international platform, people are more focusing on artisanal crafts.
Mm.
They would rather spend 1,000 ringgit worth of for a straw bag compared to a bag that is produced
mass-produced.
For example, okay. You know, it's just interesting. Like, but people are starting to understand. They're educated. They travel. They understand that, oh wow, you know, these are handwork. This literally takes hours of someone's life,
yeah,
or days or years to
they
complete.
Appreciate it.
Yes,
better, right?
Yes,
okay.
Yes. There's so many different elements, and people seem to take notice on that part for sure. So
I'm glad. Well, thank you so much for speaking to me today. I learned so much about batik just talking
you so much
to
for
you.
Having me. Yes.
I'm Melissa Idris, and you've been watching The Future is Female. Join me again same time next Saturday as I speak to more other extraordinary women right here on the show, only on Astro AWANI.